So welcome back. Last class, I discussed with you about different aspects of drug proving, especially Hahnemann and drug proving. And we have seen different aspects of drug proving, like test, drug, the personals involved in drug proving, and methodology involved in. Especially the Hahnemannian methodology. Today I am going to discuss you with the methodology of drug proving, especially homeopathic pathogenetic trial. As you know, homeopathic pathogenetic trial is a term used to refer the modern method of drug proving. In this class, we are going to discuss more about the methodology of homeopathic pathogenetic trial. Homeopathic pathogenetic trial is a process in which the drug substance are put into trial over healthy volunteers and the pathogenetic effects are observed and noted for a therapeutic purpose. And you know, Hahnemann preferred drug proving substance on himself and his trusted followers. All these proving were either open or single blind. That means the medicine was known to Hahnemann as well as his followers who took part in drug proving process. Now, in the modern era, the things are changed. In order to eliminate the false sign and subjective bias, it is proposed that a double-blind method for the proving of drugs in healthy volunteers where neither the proving master nor the prover nor the name of the drug conducted is recommended. HPT or homeopathic pathogenetic trial is a first systematic experimental approach to dictate the changes in the healthy volunteers after exposure to a drug. HPT is a clinical trial to investigate the effect of potentially toxic or pathogenetic substance diluted and attenuated according to homeopathic pharmacopoeia in non-patient volunteers in relatively stable health conditions. So as you know, the tenets of proving protocol are test, substance, proving team, and methodology. The first two tenets, that is a test, substance, and proving team, we had already discussed in last class. And today we are going to discuss more about the methodology involved in homeopathic pathogenetic trial. The design of homeopathic pathogenetic trial is a multicentric, randomized, placebo-controlled, double-blind crossover trial. So we will discuss more about the design of HPT one by one. What is multicentric trial? A multicentric trial are conducted at different locations, mountain, plain, or seashore, to study changes in the drug action due to variations in lifestyle, food habits, climate, constitutional and temperamental factors. So this is to the purpose of the multicentric trial is to discover the effect of the medicine in people living in different locations. Next one is randomized trial. So what do you mean by randomization? Randomization is a process of allocating the subjects into various groups without having any prejudiced mind, with an unprejudiced mind. So in a randomized trial, cohorts are equally allocated randomly into treatment group and placebo group. Here the randomization is done to avoid selection bias. I will explain it little more. Suppose you have a treatment group and a placebo group. A volunteer or a prover with a good sense and intelligence can be allocated to a treatment group rather than a placebo group to get more symptoms of the drug. So that is a bias. So to avoid the bias, we are randomly allocated. So without considering the intelligence or sensitiveness or any other factors or qualities of a prover, we are randomly or equally allocating the subjects or the provers into two groups. So that is the purpose of or the objective of randomization, and that is called as randomized trial. Now the next term is double blind trial. So in a double blind trial, the prover, supervisors, project directors are unaware about the allocation of drug and placebo into experimental group. So here what happens is a third person is coding the drug into alpha numerical code. The coding contains alphabet as well as numbers, not the name of the medicine or name of the treatment drug. So it contains only the alpha numeric codes in drug as well as in placebo. So you cannot identify which one is placebo and which one is drug. Okay, and who are getting the drug and who are getting the placebo is not known to anyone. So the provers, supervisors and project directors are blinded towards the knowledge of drug. And why double blind trial is done? It is to avoid the experimenter bias. So if I am a prover, if I know I am taking a drug, then I will be more conscious about recording of the symptoms. And suppose if I am a prover and I know that I am getting a placebo, I will be casual about the symptoms. So to avoid the experimental bias, we are dividing the group and we are blinding the supervisors or provers or project director. They are not aware about the knowledge of the drug and placebo, which group getting drug and which group getting placebo. Now, placebo-controlled trial. So what do you mean by placebo-controlled trial? Placebo is a substance which are mimicking the drug in its form and quality. We cannot differentiate a drug and placebo by mere looking it. So why placebo is introduced in a trial? To know, to differentiate the effect of the drug with that of placebo. Placebo is a must in identical to the drug in terms of form and nature. So how a drug looks like, the same way a placebo also. Placebo controlled trial is done to avoid experimental bias. Now, what do you mean by crossover studies? So in a crossover design, same prover act as placebo group and treatment group, but in different phase. So one group receives drug in one phase of HPT, receive placebo in the next phase. Same way, another group receive placebo in one phase, receiving drug in next phase. So there are two or more phases in a drug proving trial, where in one phase, one group receiving a drug and the same group receiving placebo the next phase. Similarly, in the first phase, if a group receives placebo, then in the next phase, the same group receives the drug. So it is a type of crossovering. So why crossover is introduced in pathogenetic trial, homeopathic pathogenetic trial? To know, to clearly differentiating the effect of placebo from the effect of drug. So these are the general designs of HPT. And there are some more aspects in HPT. So you know that a volunteer or a prover should be apparently healthy. We should assure that the volunteer is apparently healthy. How to do that? So that is with the help of a pre-medical examination, which includes physical and clinical examination, along with the constitutional, both mental and physical traits. And it also includes the pathological, biochemical, and serological test. And all these tests are done to ensure that the volunteer is an apparently healthy person. Not only that, these clinical examinations and physical examination will ensure about the pre-existing symptoms in a volunteer. That means before the drug proving, what are the symptoms are there in a volunteer or a prover. So that will be recorded in a specialized format or performer called as Initial Medical Report Performer or IMRP, Initial Medical Report Performer. Now, another performer used in HPT is the Prover's Daybook or Logbook. So what is the purpose of Prover's Daybook or Logbook? So it is a designated format wherein the prover makes the symptom entries in chronological order as per the instructions. So each prover is provided with sufficient number of pre-designated Prover's Daybook to record all the signs and symptoms, whether it is a subjective or objective, they must observe during the course of the drug proving. The provers are directed to report to the proving master every day and hand over the recorded symptoms data. And there are some guidelines for recording the symptoms. So what are the guidelines? The first guideline is they should be adhered to the proving protocol honestly and sincerely. The prover must take daybook entries at least 3 times in a day. Each entry should be recorded even the slightest deviation from the subject's normal life. Intensity and duration of the symptoms should be carefully noted. Possible exciting causes should be recorded meticulously. A detailed record of order of appearance of all symptoms should be made. Duration and modifying characters of the symptoms together with concomitants should be properly recorded. So these are the guidelines which approver should follow while recording the symptoms in daybook. And when you compare today, I was discussing about the methodology of homeopathic pathogenetic trial. Now, when you compare with the Hahnemannian drug proving and the modern HPT, see what are the similarities and dissimilarities. Similarities, it should adhere to the homeopathic philosophy. The primary aim of Hahnemannian drug proving as well as HPT is to elicit the symptoms, whether it is subjective or objective symptoms, the pathogenetic symptoms, the characteristic symptoms of the drug. Now, what are the differences in Hahnemannian proving and HPT? Or we can say, what are the methodological flaws in Hahnemannian drug proving? So in Hahnemannian drug proving, there was no control group. So in HPT, we are introducing a placebo group, which is served as a control group. Then only we can compare it with the medicine. The second methodological flaw is the absence of random allocation. That means the provers are randomly allocated in HPT, whereas in Hahnemannian drug proving, those who are not to Hahnemann, those who are followers of Hahnemann, took part in the drug proving process. The next methodological flaw in Hahnemannian drug proving is absence of blinding. So Hahnemann, the master prover, and the fellow provers know that which medicine they are proving. So what is the after effect of that? They are expecting a favorable development of symptoms after taking the drug. That may be psychological symptoms or it may be a drug effect. But one cannot differentiate it from a psychological symptom or an effect of the drug. So that is the main drawback of absence of blinding. Inclusion of pre-existing symptoms. So if a person is having a pre-existing symptom, that also is added to the drug proving symptom in Hahnemannian drug proving. Whereas in homeopathic pathogenetic trial, initial medical report pro forma closely analyze the pre-existing symptoms and record it separately. And after the completion of this homeopathic pathogenetic trial, we can differentiate with the symptoms generated due to drug effect and the pre-existing symptoms in a prover. So these are the common methodological flaws we can observe in Hahnemannian drug proving. And next is, when a drug can be considered as a thoroughly proved, a medicine can be considered to have been thoroughly proved when it satisfies the following conditions. So what are the conditions? It must be proved on suitable person of both sexes and various constitutions. That means it should be proved in different constitutions. Subsequent experiments can notice little of a novel character from its action. That means the reproving, the subsequent proving does not elicit any new symptoms other than which is observed in a previous study. So no new symptom should be generated on a second probe or subsequent probe. So almost always the same symptoms had been observed by others which are exhibited during reprobing. So the same symptoms in the previous probing should be observed in a second probing, a new probing. There is no more new symptoms. The symptoms most carefully recorded are complete with regards to its location, sensation, modality, concomitant. That means a symptom should be complete enough with its location, sensation, modality, and concomitant. And the last one is the symptom should be clinically verified. It should be clinically verified. The symptom should be verified in a patient. So when these conditions are fulfilled, then we can say a medicine can be considered as a thoroughly proved. So with this, I am concluding the topic on drug proving as well as homeopathic pathogenetic trial.